for people, places, things, now. PPTN, also the initials, not coincidentally, for the Pennsylvania Public Television Network. From this control center here in Hershey, Pennsylvania, public television programs are distributed to the 7 non-commercial stations in our state. These programs, instructional ones during the day for use in our schools, and a wide range of programs in the evening for at home or at anywhere viewing by all sorts of curious people, are then broadcast from public television stations in Philadelphia, Hershey, Allentown, Scranton, Erie, Pittsburgh, and University Park. Each week of the series, a program comes from one of our 7 stations, and each program deals with the important people, places, and things that, taken together, truly are the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. This week's program comes from WQED.
How about you, Jonah?
Oh, well, you're lucky.
Step backwards, James. You'll disappear.
Yeah, I'll fall over. Go
This is Jim Bryner's front porch in Dunbar, Pennsylvania. And these men are Jim Bryner's friends. They're all descendants of the people who settled this part of the country 200 years ago. Like the first settlers, they work with their hands, in mills, in mines, and on the farm. And like their fathers, their uncles, and grandfathers, these men are fiddlers, too. When they were young, they would listen for hours while the old-timers sat around and sipped moonshine and played the fiddle until the sun came up in the morning. These men grew up with fiddle music always as close as their own front porch.
I had a dustpan and a poker. I used to squeak it, you know, back and forth. And we was at a dance. They used to play for square dance at our house. And I was just little then. That's the first I remember. This guy used to come and play the fiddle. And they'd play it all. It was time to do the milking in the morning. And I used to sit up all night and watch this fiddle player. And all the rest of the kids would be sleeping, and I'd be standing there watching him. So one time he told my dad, he said, "That boy's going to make a fiddler." He says, "No," he says, "he won't fiddle." So he One night at the dance, he handed me the fiddle, and I picked it up and I played a tune right there. Never even had one before.
Back in the days before they brought electricity into the valleys, music like this, the kind you made at home, was what people listened and danced to when they wanted to have a good time. But radio and the phonograph and a little bit of prosperity began to change all that. And pretty soon, the back porch hillbilly music was being replaced by radio shows and the new 78s imported from the city. A lot of the old-timers packed up their fiddles and put them in the closet. There were some folks, though, who didn't. They took the music, the old mountain music, off the porch and put it on stage.
As early as 20 years ago. You never heard of any fiddle contest around?
No.
Now, way back years ago, they did have them. Cousin Lee Hall, the man I was talking about, he'd tell about fiddle contests that he'd been in and some of them that he won. And I couldn't hardly envision what he's talking about, because I'd never saw any fiddle contests yet. And then once they started having fiddle contests. And I've talked to men that, even my age, that hadn't picked up a fiddle for 30 years. And they got the fiddle out and dusted off, and now you see them going to a fiddle contest, and other young fellows, like Jim said, just coming in. I don't know about the rest of the boys, but I'm not too much of a fiddler, but I really can't do my best at a contest because you're under pressure. You know, you get up there and you're competing then.
Well, there's one thing about a contest. Now, we travel a lot of miles to contests, and almost all of us go to every contest.
Yeah.
There has to be something about it that attracts us.
Mm-hmm.
And what I think it is fellowship. And we meet a lot of different people, and we know a lot of people. And that's what I think going to contests amounts to. If we didn't care for a contest, we'd never travel 100 miles one way, 200 miles.
Mm-hmm.
But we go to every one, so we must like it.
Good afternoon, everyone. everyone. Welcome in to the site of the 8th Annual ABBA Old Time Fiddlers Contest, live and direct from Princeville, Maryland.
Now, Henry Ford probably did more to help save the old mountain music than just about anybody. Along with his Model T's and his Model A's, Henry was crazy about fiddle tunes, and it pained him to think that radio and the new dance music might snuff them out. So, in 1926, he ordered his car dealers to sponsor fiddle contests all over the country. Pretty soon, the old-timers were coming out of the hills, happy to meet old friends and swap new tunes. But they were also eager to get their hands on some of that prize money Henry was offering. The idea caught on. Today, just about every town in the Appalachian Mountains can brag about its own summertime fiddle contest.
Okay, James Bryner. He's from Dunbar, Pennsylvania, and a regular performer here at Springfield. Let's hear it for James Bryner. Again, this is the category of fiddlers age 60 and over, and Mr. Bryner has made his way up to our microphone. What are we going to hear?
Woodchopper's Reel.
Woodchopper's Reel.
At Jim Bryner's house, for as long as he can remember, Sunday afternoon was a time when you took your fiddle off the shelf, sat around on the back porch, and played and talked with your friends and neighbors.
Where's good old grandma?
Yeah, we've been waiting for 3 days for this, me and John.
No. Oh, really?
Fiddle music had grown up here on the back porch, among friends.
I told him not to eat for 3 days.
And even though contests helped preserve the sound of the old mountain tunes, when fiddlers moved off the porch and onto the stage, something just as important was left behind. On the back porch, there weren't any crowds or judges. There was no prize money or any of the other tensions that go along with spotlights and stages. Back porch fiddling, like a granddaddy's recollection of times past, was more easygoing than all that.
Now, Albie didn't have much of an education, but you talk about playing a fiddle. Now, I could finger a fiddle just exactly like him, but I couldn't bring out that tune that that man had. Some of them's just got a touch there that nobody else has got.
Well, it's like him.
Yeah?
Yeah. I'll show you after a while.
Okay, John. How about you?
Well, I know one thing. I'm going to get out of this hot sun before I get another blister on my
Well, I started out with the idea of get out and playing for some dances, you know, and making a fortune. Well, I got rich.
Pass the hat and you got 75 cents.
Sometimes you're lucky to get your hat back. But you know, okay. Better luck next time, yeah. That's where it all got started. What did you learn from first year?
That's the first
two never wanted. Right, yeah. Hi, Jim. Let's play the Golden Slippers and harmonize on them. We'll let the other boys in, wouldn't
we? Okay. I think my first recollection of it was my dad playing when I was small. And then I got to hear my granddad, Bryner, play once. And he was out of this world. And he was really a fiddler. He had a big beard, and when he went to play, he'd pull that beard out of there and put the fiddle up underneath it. And he could really play a fiddle. And then I had my mother's uncle lived right below us. And I used to go down and torture him to play me a tune. I say, hey, Uncle Jim, how about playing a tune on a fiddle? And he was very good. And he was pretty well up in years at that time, and he would call to his daughter in the house, he'd say, hey, Laura, get me my violin. He always called the violin, and he could really play.
It started way back years ago with these old people, our dads and our uncles and all them old people. There was no television, there was no radio. You just had to make your own thing, you know. And they worked hard, but still didn't pick up that fiddle.
And back in those days, I remember when I was a kid, and especially up at Doan's home and up at my granddad's, we went to bed when it got dark because you didn't have nothing but an oil lamp. And this time of year, as soon as it ever got dark, we were in bed. And you didn't have anything else to occupy your time, so it was only natural if your uncle was sitting there playing a fiddle and somebody else playing a banjo, it was only natural for you to have an inclination to want to play. And when they'd lay a banjo down, for instance, we'd grin and start playing on a banjo or pick a fiddle up and start playing.
I started, and I can't read music. I wish I could. Maybe I'd be one of those, what'd you call them, Jim, a little bit ago?
Simple.
Those high-class players?
Concert violin.
Yeah. I paid $6 for my first fiddle, and I still got it. And there's no strings on it, no keys or nothing. But it's an old-timer, ain't it, Jim?
Did your family play there before you?
No. Our brother took lessons in a banjo, and he can't play to this day. He's the only one out of the bunch of musically inclined.
How did you learn all these old things?
Playing with other people. Go around, set, and listen. My dad played drums, but he couldn't hold any melody. He just played drums, you know, kept time. And I'd hear him whistle a few, you know, but he never played no music otherwise.
Well, that's another thing. Now, whistling, you used to always hear fellows whistling those old mountain tunes. You don't hear nobody whistle anymore.
No.
They forgot how.
Well.
Mountain music is like most American folk music. It's a kind of music that you carry around in your head and whistle when you feel like it. There's an old hillbilly saying, if a tune's written down and played from notes on a music stand, it ain't fiddling music anymore. It's violin music. Today, among the young people who still have roots back in the country, there are a lot more violinists growing up than there are fiddlers. This doesn't mean that this back porch hillbilly music is dying out, only that, like the men who play it, it's getting old. Kids are drifting away from their granddad's playing and storytelling. For some, though, the back porch fiddle tunes are still an important part of their life. They, for the most part, learn their music in school and play it mostly for concerts or for contests. But it just ain't the same there. No public school violin teacher can show a kid how to play with the same feeling that an old-time fiddler can. And a spotlit stage is a long way off from a backcountry porch.
That's our program for this week. Next week, another program from one of Pennsylvania's seven public television stations on PPTN. For People, Places, Things, Now, I'm John Roberts.